do find online, actually, in many lists, according to CNN and Bloomberg, the taxi industry does show up. According to quite a bit of data, you are more likely to be killed on the job as a taxi driver than as a police officer or a firefighter, which is quite fascinating, actually. And the city finds they have an obligation to protect the passenger, but it seems that the driver is in more danger. I wonder if the city would consider an ordinance change that would require anyone who wants to ride in a taxi to get a full background check and wear a medallion around their neck. And of course, this may seem a bit absurd, but it's perhaps no more absurd than the current ordinance. And obviously, I don't come here to seek more regulation on the industry, but echo the concerns about regulation at all, and to deregulate the industry and let the free market take over. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you all for your comments and for cooperating with your time limits. I appreciate that. And everyone being respectful to everyone else, thank you. So next, we have,
to allow the site more creep next plan.
Second.
All those papers say aye, please?
Aye.
Aye, Luce. Okay, thank you, Your Honor. This is something that is under my name, and it is and it would be the acceptance of the Sagamore Creek Brewery Committee's report.
So, speakers,
hey, Your Honor, I could answer Councilor Thorson's. He had a couple questions, and I could answer a couple of them, and then if David Moore could answer the more technical ones about the DDS. Okay.
I
can make a motion to accept. Motion to accept the
second.
Councilor Thorson had a question about the cap and the hours of operation and the
lighting.
Okay. We discussed the hours of usage for the park quite a bit, and our feeling was twofold. One, in terms of enjoyment of the land during the winter, if we were going to make it limited to daylight hours, well, that would kind of nail it. You know, some months it would be there for a few minutes only, open and close. So we knew that there are people, and I'm one of them, who enjoy being outdoors at nighttime, whether you're into astronomy and you're looking, you can't do it in the daytime, or whether you're into cross-country skiing by moonlight, or any number of activities that can be enjoyed at nighttime. We didn't want to foreclose that. And that kind of connects with the other concern, which is illegal activity or vagrants or drug usage or anything like that. I think it goes to a theme of by encouraging more usage by people who are there to enjoy it for all the right reasons, it's less likely that there'll be people there for the wrong reasons. So, I mean, that's kind of a running theme throughout this thing, is to encourage the uses that, in some cases, are already happening, but by doing it in an open way, I think will reduce the problems that you're mentioning. I guess, David, you could mention the DES.
And if I may also address the carry in, carry out issue related to the trash. There was also a discussion at the committee level thinking about managing trash, another concept of more eyes on the site. The issue of carry in, carry out is trying to emulate what other natural areas do managed by governmental entities, encouraging people and having an expectation that what takes in is taken out. That will be able to be assessed if it is not working. Approach, I think the staff would follow up on that. Also, we have we have a relationship with DES that we have had in formal capacity with regard to managing this site for the 30-plus years that has been closed. There are specific requirements that we follow up on related to groundwater data sampling at the site that goes for surface water as well, and generally follow up and have performed under the closure plan requirements. That being said, we expect that the DES, in working with us on implementing your policy, if that is a decision that you make, would want us to refresh and update the existing conditions at the site as it relates to those groundwater, any groundwater concerns, the condition of the cap, which well known and have been monitored over time. Still, this represents an opportunity to create a new baseline of understanding. And certainly through that process, DES does not think it is warranted, safe, or advisable to utilize the space in a way that's envisioned. We won't be doing that. But we expect to work with them on those issues proactively, and we have not expended any funds in this in the work leading up to tonight as a committee, knowing that as we move forward with the final, move toward the implementation stages, we'll be required to do things just like that to ensure that we are inviting people to a formally use a safe space.
So can I follow up with a couple of questions? In terms of what public comments people had, and Councilor Thorson's other concerns. A lot of people, in fact, people in favor and against what we proposed tonight, talked about preserving the site as it is, which is interesting. And I think what we believe as a committee, in fact, is that the best way to preserve the site as it is and to preserve the natural elements and preserve the wildlife there is by adopting the plan. Because, in fact, the way the site is structured right now, having to walk around the fence into wetlands to get to it, having to walk on trails that sometimes waterlogged and then walk around the trail, having to go on to the meadow where there is no demarked place to go, having to go, if you want to get the water access, make your own way, that's actually not gonna, that goes against long-term preservation of the site, of wilderness, of nature. So we believe that we can achieve the ostensible goal of pretty much everyone who spoke by adopting this plan, which formalizes a whole ethos of conservation and preservation. Secondly, in terms of the traffic, some of the speakers already really alluded to this. A lot of the traffic that we're talking about is due to the other businesses on Jones Avenue. I think in government, sometimes it takes something else to be a catalyst for what should have happened a while ago. But in this case, maybe that's this plan. And I think it's that type of thing where the council then can look at it in terms of the capital plan, in terms of the traffic and safety committee, to see what can we do to improve traffic management on Jones Avenue. So I think that is something that will, of course, have to take the time for some of these steps to become implemented. Finally, I'll say as just overall as a philosophy, I believe that having more users and more stakeholders on public land like this gets everybody in the community into the mind of preserving and putting resources towards preservation for this land. The more people who know about it, the more people who use it, the more people are going to get behind putting CD resources into preserving that for future generations. If fewer people know about it, if fewer people use it, then some people might say, well, I don't know about it, so who cares? I don't know what's going on there. But if more people are enjoying and experiencing it, then I think the city as a whole, long term, you'll have a lot more stakeholders who see the value in keeping it the way it is. So that's why I think opening up the gates to allow that type of access is good for the long term health of the parcel. And I'm hoping, as I wrap up here, if Councilor Dwyer can also do a good job in addressing some of the concerns of students.
So the list of speakers I have Councilor Kennedy, Councilor Shaheen, Assistant Mayor Swain, and Councilor Dwyer.
Mark, maybe someone can inform me on that. Because my real concern is, being kind of not in a butter, but someone pretty close to Pierce Island, is a lot of the upkeep of those trails and everything is a group of people that live in that area. And we just received a numerous list of people that are against this project. So who is going to keep up these trails? The people that keep up the trails on Pierce Island are a lot of volunteers. We worked really hard. We had Timberland Comp. I mean, but it's mostly people that live in that area. So my question goes back, I guess, to the city, knowing the amount of complexity to keep the trails, how much wood and how much trash that I've carried out of Pierce Island with groups of people that are volunteering. We even have Blue Oceans to support us over there. So I guess my question is who's going to take care of all of these trails? I mean, we just have to talk to urban forestry to know the complexity of that. The second question I have is urban forestry. They do a really good job of putting time limits out at night. They have a gate that shuts at 9 o'clock. And basically, there's no access at that point. So did anyone do some conversation with urban forestry to see how they manage their property? We're very similar in a similar area. When we were doing the master plan a long time ago, the first master plan, and talking about this in the school, there were some conservationists who talked about deer runs that ran through the property. And one of their concerns to change the property was because of these deer runs that are running through the property. And also, as the young lady spoke very eloquently about the 5 endangered species potential could be there. There's a lot of that discussion we talked about the school, and that was one of the reasons we didn't bring it there. That was one of the reasons I felt strongly about keeping it on Paradise, was to keep this a space for our natural environment. I mean, I think Margot said it very nicely, that we need a place for our non-domesticated animals to roam and be part of, and to do pure science. I mean, it sounds like a great idea. So I have some concerns with those things, and I didn't really hear them being brought up. And the other thing is, if we had all these meetings and all these individuals who came and spoke tonight, and I'm assuming they spoke at the other meetings, talked about another traffic pattern, was that discussed by the committee? In other words, was there a discussion at any point about the traffic pattern coming in from the school versus coming in from the road? So I guess before I can say yes, those are the things I need answers to personally, because I remember a lot of these things being discussed when we were talking about the school being there and the rationale for not having the school there and moving to Parrot Ave was a lot of these things that I'm hearing the citizens talk about. So maybe I need some answers, and maybe it can't be tonight, but I can't vote tonight. Okay.
So, Your Honor, we have the chair of the committee here and the Councilor Dwyer. Maybe they could respond to some of those.
Sure. Do you want to get other questions first, or do you want to respond to those?
Probably get the other questions on the table.
Yeah.
Okay, let's see if we have other questions. Councilor Shaheen.
So I have two questions. One, I'm curious to hear if the access point was explored, if you all evaluated other opportunities for how to access the parcel, and if so, why those might be ruled out. And two, if there's been any assessment of what these types of changes to the parcel mean in terms of volume, impact, and foot traffic, car traffic. And I guess I just would add one other, for just a point of clarification, because I read the way the petition was framed, and in some of the comments it concerned me that there may have been this understanding or confusion about a recreational facility or fields, and just clarification that wasn't part of the intended plan. So
let's get all the questions out there, okay? Then
yeah.
I see you taking copious notes,
yeah.
So thank you. Somebody explain.
Well, I have no questions. I certainly have a comment or two, but if you want to go through the questions first, as long as I can make a comment afterwards.
We'll come back to you. Then I have Councillor Wong.
I have comments only, Your Honor.
Okay, so hold that, Councillor Boyd. Questions or comment?
Comments. Maybe follow-up questions.
Okay, hold that. Then I'm going to go back to Councillor Dwyer so we can look at questions.
Sure.
And if there are comments after, then we'll let you make them in a very succinct way, please.
Yeah, Eric, help me if I didn't get all the questions, but I'll respond to the ones that I have notes on here. High school uses, I think, is a really important one to respond to, because I was surprised to hear from what the high school students said, because we had at public hearings a number of high school teachers who teach the classes for outdoor classrooms and that kind of thing, talk about the value of the property for that purpose. And that was one thing we wanted to preserve. And we also had the high school cross-country folks who keep the trails come and talk to us about that. And the middle school folks who use the trails also talk to us about that. And so those were central in what we wanted to preserve. And in fact, one of the things we talked about was protection in the vernal pool area where the classrooms often gather, potentially simple wooden benches where the high school students might sit during outdoor classrooms. So that was central to what we're preserving. I think it's important, there does seem to be some confusion, and people in our neighborhood who have been provided with misinformation did contact me. When I sent them to the actual plan on the site, most of them felt their questions had been answered, because there's no intent for commercialization. I'm not sure how that word even came into this. There's no intention for building a facility. There's no intention for recreation fields. We certainly had people come to us and say they wanted fields, they wanted a golf course, but if you looked at what we provided, you see we said that all of those uses were not appropriate. So I know that there's been a certain amount of building up in people's minds of what this could be, but that, in fact, is the reason we're doing this plan. Because if you look at the tenants of the plan, they're all the same tenants of conservation easements. They're all the same legal things that you would do with a conservation easement, the kinds of uses. Access is a good question. You know, on many nights in this council, we talk about bike, pedestrian, and we are hoping that more and more people will use bikes and pedestrian access. We're certainly hoping that for this site. The high school access point is very well developed for pedestrian access. And we saw, David didn't point it out, that there is an improvement on a trail there which allows a walk over a bridge. We want to build a little bridge there to, again, protect the environment underneath it, where you could walk from the high school parking lot to this site from that access. You know, we certainly can't take away the road that's there. The road goes down to Tidewatch, the road goes down Joan Avenue, the road goes down to the Elks. That road's going to be there. But what we want to do by improving access on the other site and connecting it to the bike route that will go down Route 1, and in fact would enable someone to go over to the Urban Forestry Center on bicycle, is to connect those trails and make those possible. So yeah, we did talk about that access and really want to build up that use of it. You know, that I think goes along with all the improved pedestrian bike access we need in the whole area. Volunteers is a great, Esther raised a great question around stewardship. While they're not here tonight, at many of our meetings, we had many, many people from the Tidewatch community who use this site regularly and who really were eager to be part of stewardship for this site. So, and you'll see in the plan, much like you talked about with Pierce Island, because we really did model this on Pierce Island, that a group of volunteers who would do the kind of things that you guys have done would be essential to this. Now, it's hard to do that before you have some improvements, as you know, on Pierce Island. The kind of the stewardship for that has increased and increased. But the Tidewatch people, who typically were at our meetings by numbers of 10 to 15 each time, had a lot of input into this and liked that aspect of it. Margo mentioned that the dogs is a sensitive issue, and because of the wildlife